Okay, so today we'll basically continue with higher order functional programming. There was a question about what will be on the final, and the final will be purely on functional programming. Basically, all everything that we learned about functional programming, the existence of first class functions, basically parameters that can be functions, and we actually will cover this today. Until now, we covered basics of functional programming. Basically, how do you use functional programming? You use it, you first of all have to decompose the problem into a recursive decomposition of the problem, because everything in functional programming is a function that applies either on a base case or it's solved by solving a sub case, a smaller case of the previous case. Okay, so, and we'll cover more advanced topics today. We'll basically cover higher order functions, which are basically when you do pass a parameter that is a function, and we'll also cover carrying, which is basically a partial application of a function. If you only pass a subset of the parameters of that function, basically you have a function that is expects the rest of the parameters. So this is partial evaluation. And today we'll continue with SML programming, and we'll also do a lab like we did the last two labs before the Thanksgiving break on SML and problems. We have, beside this lecture, two more lectures, which are also about functional programming. Next lecture, we basically finish advanced topics in functional programming, and we also have a lab again on SML functions. And the last lecture, the following Monday, will basically be a review for the final. So the final for this class will be 10 problems in SML that cover all the topics that we covered in SML up to now. Basically, how do you define functions recursively, especially when you have lists? Then we'll discuss how do you use higher order functions, like the standard functions that we learned about earlier this semester, map, and then filter and other functions, and carrying. And we'll basically cover functional programming, 10 problems of 10 points each, all essay type, no more questions that multi-choice questions. They will all be questions, implement this in SML. There are two questions on the chat. Let me see. Is just information covered in the functional programming in SML slides? Yes, that's the only topic for the final. The final exam will be only on functional programming. I do not want to get into the other topics because basically this semester it's almost over. One more week of lectures, and I already put the lectures up. If you want to read through them and ask me, I would be very happy to respond to questions about the rest of the material about principles of programming languages. In fact, my research is in Prolog, which is a logic programming language, and other associated logic programming paradigms like answer set programming, transaction logic, theorem proving. And I will be very happy to tell you more about logic programming and applications of logic programming, but not this semester. This semester we did data structures, and we'll do functional programming for the rest of the semester. And functional programming will be the only topic that we'll cover in the final exam. And this is in the recording that I will post on Piazza after the class. Okay, so let's return back to functional programming, in particular higher order functions. So last class we finished with this. In functional programming languages, the whole idea is that functions are what is called first class members. It basically means that you can use as a parameter another function. And this is the main use of functional programming in any kind of application that you are interested in. Mostly in user interfaces, the use of functional programming is for event programming. Basically, if an event is triggered on a certain user interface component, if you remember in CSE 160, we talked about JavaFX, the moment that you click a button, the method that will be called is a method that is standardized for that user interface UI component. And it's actually this method that will be called is an example of a functional programming example, higher order functional programming. You're actually passing as a parameter to this event handler the function that will be called when the event is triggered. Moreover, functional programming is very useful for distributed applications, especially those that can be horizontally distributed. That basically means that you have a large collection and you want to apply a function on all the elements of that collection. The idea of distributed computing is that now you can split that collection into partitions, and these are called with different names in different frameworks. For instance, in NoSQL databases, they are called shards. They are the part, the shared part of a large collection on which you apply a certain function. And the idea of MapReduce is exactly this, that you apply the function distributed on multiple of these components, and each component runs faster than running one single computer on the entire collection. Then you can filter the results. Maybe you only want those that for a certain function it's true, like all the pages that contain the word Fodor and the word CSE 260. And you can do it for the entire internet if you have a large collection of computers on which you distributed all the web pages over the internet. And the map function basically, and also the filter function that we'll see later, takes a function and a list. And basically they apply the function on all the elements of that list. The first definition of this map that you see here is basically that the map takes the function, and if it takes the empty list, then the result is the empty list. There is no element on which to apply that function. However, if the map takes a function and a list that has a head, a first element, and a tail, the rest of the elements in that list, then you apply the function on the first element and you const that, you put that at the beginning of the result that is given by map of that function and the tail of the list. So basically the idea is that you apply the function on the first element and then you apply the function on the rest of the elements recursively. The same thing can be written not in the pattern notation, but in this other notation that you take F and the list L as the parameters. If the list is empty, then you return empty. There is nothing to apply the function on. Else you apply the function on the head of the list, and you const that, you put that at the beginning of applying the function on the tail of the list. And basically, you can even see in the definition of this function map that it's a function from the Cartesian product of functions that apply to elements in the domain A with values in the domain B, with a list of elements on the domain A, and you get a list of elements in the domain B. So basically, the map function takes a function and a list of elements with elements in the domain of that function, and it returns a list of elements in the codomain of that function. So here is an example. We define a square. That square of x is x multiplied with x. And if you apply map on square, this function that we defined, and the list of elements, you get the squares of those elements. So it's a straightforward definition that uses a higher level function, higher order function. So let me just show you that this is straightforward as you would expect in SML. We define the function map. It takes a function, and I will use the extended notation. So it takes a function and the list, and we define it as if the list is empty, then you return the empty list, else you return you return the function f applied on the head of the list L, cons with the function map applied to f and the tail of the list L. So now we can basically call the function map. Let's actually define another function. Now we can define square because we already saw it. So it takes an integer and returns also an integer, which is the square of x with itself. So now map, and you can basically pass square as a parameter, and it takes a list of elements. And let's say that we pass 5, maybe 7, maybe 10 as parameters. And it basically returns the square of each one of them. Instead of 5, we got 25. Instead of 7, we got 49. And instead of 10, we got 100. So you can vary either one of them. You can vary the function that is the first parameter, or you can vary the list. So that's the whole idea of higher order functions. Now, another thing that all functional programming languages offer, and in fact, imperative programming languages offer too, like since Java 8, Java has anonymous functions. So basically what you can do is define that function that you want as your function for basically that function that you apply in line, directly in the line where you actually invoke the function map. So as you can see here, I call the function map on a new function that for any x, it returns x plus 1. And since 1 is an integer, it also infers the fact that this is a function from integers to integers. And I pass a list of integers, for instance, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And now it applies this function on every one of those integers. So I get as the result, the function, the result is the list that contains 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay. So that's actually tried. So the same function map that we saw before, now it takes an anonymous function as a parameter. And the notation is quite standard that for every, that it defines a function that for every x returns x plus 1. And then you can basically pass a list of elements, 4, 6, 2, 10. And as I basically said, this is an increment function. It's basically identical with defining basically an increment function. Now, as I said before, you can actually also assign such a function to another function. So the advantage here is that you actually define a new function. So increment of list is the function map with that anonymous function on the same list that it passes as a parameter. So this is an increment list function. So this is an undefined function, basically is defining only the parameterized function, the first part, and the list is still left as unbound, as a new variable that will be defined later. Now, the advantage here is that you have a new function increment that takes the list that you want to increment, the second parameter, and it basically applies that function on. So this is a first use of partially defined functions. So map is partially defined. It basically takes only the function that is the first parameter as the parameter. The second one is actually left for later to be initialized. Okay. So again, the function increment list, an entire list of values. It's more defined what is that abbreviation, takes a list actually, and is defined as map that takes the anonymous function that increments every x to x plus 1. And it's the same list as the second parameter. So now we can use increment list on a list of parameters. And now basically we can pass in any integers that we want And let's put 10 as we had in the previous examples. So it increments every element with 1. Okay, so these are examples of using anonymous functions. Now, another example. So all of you that took with me CSC 160 and probably also in CSC 150, you are familiar with McCarthy 91 function. It's one function that has an interesting property that it has a fixed point for every value less than 100. It has a fixed point that every value will be basically the function is equal with 91. It's a fixed point function defined as follows. McCarthy 91 of any integer n, positive integer. If n is greater than 100, then it's n minus 10. So basically for everything that is greater than 100, it's just n minus 10. Else, McCarthy 91 is of n is equal with McCarthy 91 of McCarthy 91 of n plus 11. So it's a straightforward recursive definition. Now, one thing that you can see, so first of all, I want to expand this function. So let's say that let's define it here with this definition, and then we'll apply it to see how does it actually compute that fixed point of 91. So what is McCarthy 91 of 99? Okay, that's the first value that we want to compute it for. By definition, since n is not greater than 100, is McCarthy 91 of McCarthy 99 of n plus 11. Okay, so now we replace n with 99, and 99 plus 11 is going to be 110. No, because it's 99 plus 1 is 100, plus 10, 110. Okay. So now we can continue. So basically now we can compute McCarthy of 110. So McCarthy 91 of, and McCarthy 91 of 110, since n is greater than 100 is n minus 10. So it's simple, it's 100, okay? What is McCarthy 91 of 100? So again, by definition, since n is not greater than 100, it's not strictly greater than 100, will be McCarthy 91 of McCarthy 91 of n plus 11. So 100 plus 11 is 111. And again, because 111 is greater than 100, this will be equal with McCarthy 91 of 101. And since 101 is greater than 100, is directly n minus 10, 101 minus 10, which is equal with 91. So we finally got 91. One thing that you can observe here is that McCarthy 99 is the same with McCarthy 1 of 100. It's the same with McCarthy 91 of 101. Okay. So let's see what is McCarthy 91 of 98, one value before 99, okay? So again, we use the same definition. Since it's not greater than 100, it's McCarthy 91 of McCarthy 91 of n plus 11. 98 plus 11 is basically 98 plus 11, is basically 109. And again, we basically apply the function. So this will be equal to McCarthy 91 of 109 minus 10, because it's greater than 100. So it's of 99, which we already computed, it was above. So basically this after a bunch of steps was McCarthy 91 of 100, and which was McCarthy 91 of 101, which was in the end equal with 91. And you can actually apply the same idea for McCarthy 91 of 97. So if you apply it now on 97, after a bunch of steps, it will be basically McCarthy 91 of 1998. So first of all, it will be McCarthy 99 of McCarthy 91 of 108. Again, we apply the function, and this is McCarthy 91 of 98, which we already computed it in the previous case, and it was equal after a bunch of steps, after some number of steps with 91. And the same applies to all of the values less than basically, again, McCarthy 91 on 97 after a bunch of steps will be equal with McCarthy 91 of 98, which, or actually 97, we already did 96 after a bunch of steps is the same with 97. And this is equal with 91 after a bunch of steps. So it's an interesting function, because no matter what you pass as values less than 101, in fact, the function will eventually be mapping that to 91, okay? And the advantage of map is that you can apply the function on any one of the values of basically of a list. Okay. So I don't know if you want me to go into details, but I will go to define the function, and then I will apply map with McCarthy 91 on a bunch of elements. And in fact, I'm gonna apply it to lower values. So you can actually see that after many, many recursions, they are basically all mapped to 91, okay? It's just an interesting function. Okay. So the next higher level function that we want to basically cover is filter. So filter takes a function that has as codomain basically Boolean type true or false and a list of elements, and then applies that function on all of the elements of that list. Those elements for which the function, the Boolean function, was true, they are kept in the result. If the Boolean function was not true, they are not kept in the result. So it's an actual filter. It takes a Boolean function and a list, and you get the elements from the list for which that Boolean function was true. So how is it defined? If the list is empty, then you return empty because there is nothing to be filtered out. Basically, it's the same empty list. If the function applied to the head of the list is true, then basically the head of the list is kept in the result, and you put that at the beginning of filter of the same function on the tail of the list. Else, you don't keep the head of the list, you directly return the filter of that function on the tail of the list. And you can actually see that this filter function takes as parameters a function that maps every element to a Boolean value, a list of elements of that same type, and it returns a list of elements of that type, basically those elements from that second parameter for which the first function was true. And here I have an example. For instance, if I have a function that checks if an element is strictly positive or not, and I pass a list of integers that may contain negative values, zero, and positive values, the result of filtering with this function, that list, is the list of elements that are all positive, strictly positive. Okay, so filter is really a filter that from a list of elements keeps those for which the filter function, the first argument, is true. So let me actually write it down. So again, the function filter, and I'm going to write it in a least abstract way. So takes a function and the list. If the list is empty, it returns empty. Else, if the function is true for the head of the list, then it keeps the head of the list. It counts that to filter with the same function on the tail of the list L. Else, it just basically returns filter of that function on the tail of the list L. Okay, so now we can basically invoke filter, and we can create an anonymous function. I want the function that for every x, it checks if x is positive. Okay. And I pass a list of elements. Unary minus is this tilde sign in SML. It makes a distinction between binary minus and unary minus. So I can basically pass a bunch of values, some negative and some positive. And it keeps only the positive values. So you can basically see from all of these values, those that are strictly positive are kept. That's a basic filter, a function that filters from a list of values, those that satisfy some function. Okay, let's get into more interesting applications of functions, of higher level functions. So permutations. You remember in Java or basically Python, if you learn Python, that permutations is quite difficult to write. So for instance, in Python, you would basically have to create permutations by thinking recursively, how would you generate all the possible permutations of a list? And this is exactly how am I going to do it for permutations in SML, okay? So let me actually give you directly the definition. How do you do recursively, or how do you do the permutations of a list, recursive or not? So how do you compute all the possible permutations of a list, like 1, 2, 3? So recursively, you can, so first of all, what are all the possible permutations? So basically one permutation is 1, 2, 3 itself. Okay. Another permutation would be actually moving one. So would be maybe 2, 3, maybe 2, 1, 3. Okay. Another permutation would be 2, 3, 1. Maybe now we can actually flip 3 and 2. So another possible permutation would be 1, 3, and 2. Another possible permutation would be 3, 1, 2. And another possible permutation is 3, 2, 1. Okay. The question is, what's the relationship between all of the permutations of 1, 2, 3 and the original list 1, 2, 3. Maybe some of you already see it. Half of them, so first of all, you can look at the tail of this list. So the list 2 and 3 has two permutations, 2 and 3, and 3 and 2. Now, for each one of these permutations of 2 and 3, you can insert one either at the beginning, after 2, or after 3. So that's how we got these three permutations. Basically, we took all of the possible permutations of 2 and 3, and for every permutation, we inserted one into one of the possible positions of that permutation. So that's exactly what I would like to write in functional programming, that the permutations, and that now I will write a pseudocode in this style. So permutate all the possible permutations of a list, like for instance, L, can be obtained by inserting, interleaving in every possible positions in all the possible permutations of the tail of the list L, the head of the list L. This is really pseudocode, so don't take it as this is not SML really. So The idea is, what I want to write is that in order to compute the permutations of a list, I will compute all of the permutations of the tail of that list, okay? And then in each one of those permutations, I will insert the head in every single possible position, okay? So interleave in all the permutations, the head of the list into each one of those permutations. So that's the idea of how you compute all the possible permutations of a list. Basically, you compute the permutations of the tail of the list, and then for every one of those, you insert the head into every possible position. Okay. And that you will, this way you get all the possible permutations of that original list. And you can basically, you scale it down, no matter how many levels you have permutations of four elements. You compute all the permutations of the three elements, and then for each one of them, you take the fourth element, the head of the previous element to that previous tail, and you insert it in every single possible position for every one of those permutations, okay? So that's actually the idea, how you do permutations. You interleave the head in each one of the permutations of the tail of that list. Now, how do I do that? I basically use functional programming, higher level functions. So my interleave, this is my first function. My interleave takes an element and a list. And what I would like is every single interleaving of that element in that list. So the first way is, if you give me the empty list, there is only one possible interleaving of that element in the empty list, which is the list that contains the list that contains X. My interleave for an element and the list will basically first break that the list into the head and the tail. One possible interleaving is to put the element X before the head and the tail. So basically, the cons operator is right associative. So this is the same list as we got as a parameter H followed by the rest of the list T, tail. And I put X right at the beginning before each one of them. So this gives me one list. And now I const that with the result of map. So what map does, takes a list, basically every one of, for every list that I get, basically my interleave interleaves X in the tail of that list. Now, given that X was interleaved in the tail of that list, for every one of those lists, I put a head at the beginning. Okay, so let me actually show you how this works, and then I will explain to you basically how I did it more in more detail. Okay, so let's say I have my interleave of an element 1 into 2 and 3. So what are the results that basically are returned? First of all, it returns a list of lists. First of all, the first element is 1, 2, 3 as a list. Then my interleave of X and tail will basically give every interleaving of 1 in the list that contains 3. So basically, I would get 1, 3 and 3, 1. What this function map at the beginning says, for every one of these, put H at the beginning, the head of this list, which is 2, put it at the beginning. So 2 and 2. So basically what my interleave does, and it does it recursively, it takes an element and the list, and it puts this element in every single position, before the list, within the elements of the list, or right at the end. Because as you can see here, I basically calling it with such a case will give me the list that contains the lists 1, 2, 3, which is obtained by basically this one. Then the list that contains 2, 1, 3, the head followed by the interleaving of X in the tail, or the list 2, 3, 1, which is basically putting now 1 at the end. Okay, so let me give you another example. What if I basically call my interleave of 1 in 2, 3, 4? Again, what you get as a result is first the list that contains 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 2 followed by, and again, now basically we have 1 interleaved in 3, 4. So it's going to be 2, 1, 3, 4, and then 2 interleaved in 1 is interleaved in 3 and 4. So basically we have 3, 1, 4. So it keeps the order, okay? And basically we have all of these possible cases. 2, 3, 4, 1. That's the idea of my interleave. Basically, it takes an element and a list and inserts that element in every single position in that list, before the list, within the list, or after the list. Okay, that's my interleave function. And I basically, these are two examples, but I have more examples below. If you pass an empty list, it returns the list with that one. If you pass an element, one single element in the list, it returns 1 followed by that element, or that element followed by 1. And then if you basically call the function with 1 and 2 elements, it basically returns 1 followed by those two elements, or the first element followed by 1 followed by the second element, or both elements followed by 1. So that's the idea of interleave. It's just, it creates, using this higher level function, all the possible interleavings of one element in a list of elements. Okay. So my interleave, and I will write it now on a bigger example. What if I pass 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? Basically returns all of the possible interleavings of one in that list, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 1 could be at the beginning, or it could be after 2, or it could be after 3, or it could be after 4, and so on. So that's the first function, basically for permutations. The second function is just an append all. So you will see later that basically I compute the interleavings as first, take the first permutation and create every interleaving, and then take the second permutation and create every interleaving. And because you have all of these lists of possible interleavings, you have to concatenate them all. So that's the idea of append all. If you pass a list of lists, basically it will concatenate those lists of lists. It will eliminate one level of listing. So you basically get the list that contains 1, 2, followed by the list that contains 2, 1. You had in the call a list of lists of lists. Okay. So now we can actually write permutations. So given the empty list, there is one possible permutation of the empty list, which is the list that contains the list, the empty list. Otherwise, permuting a list that contains a head and a tail calls append all. And now a second use of map. So first of all, I create all the possible permutations of the tail. Then for every single permutation, I get the function map. For every single permutation, it takes that permutation and it interleaves the head into that permutation. That's why I get a list of lists for every one permutation. And then I append all of them at the first level. So this is exactly how this permute. So it's basically a second function that beside the append all that solves the entire permutation problem. Basically, I compute the permutations of all of the tails, and then for every tail, I insert the head in every single position in that tail. And it works. So let me actually write both of them so you can see it in action. Oops. So append all, permute. And now basically the use of permute. So I can basically call permutations on this list. Or let me add a few elements. What about 5, 6, 7? And it contains, it creates all the possible permutations. Okay. So again, I will explain again how permute works. If you pass the empty list, it returns the empty list. That's basically the list that contains the empty list, because it's a list of permutations. And that's the only permutation of the empty list. If you pass a list that has a head, that means that it contains at least one element. First, compute all the permutations of the tail. For every one of those permutations, apply the function, the anonymous function defined here, that for every list, now call myInterleaf of the head that I took out from that original list with the list that was obtained as a permutation. So basically, this permute is a list of permutations. Now I take the head and I put it in every one of those permutations. Okay, that will give me for every one of these lists a list of possible permutations. Then I append all of these permutations. Basically, the list of permutations, I append them into a big list of all the possible permutations. That is it. Two very ingenious uses of map, basically, to define one other function, permute. Any questions? So feel free to ask questions, because this is quite a complicated function that uses these higher level functions.
So I think it was mentioned like one or two slides ago, but there was a function called, I think the one right after this slide. Two slides forward.
Okay, interleave?
Yeah, so there was one point in the function where it has the map function called, but then there's this call for fn of l. Is that some, function that you specify when creating the mapping for the permutations, or is it something else completely?
Okay. So I call recursively interleave on the x and the tail, and this will give me interleavings of x in the tail. Now, yes, when you invoke the function map, you basically map takes as parameters a function and a list. So what this anonymous function does, this is just a standard example of anonymous function. Basically, it's a function. And what this does, it takes every... So first of all, this, you can use any variable. I use L, but you could use anything that you want to name the elements of the result of the second parameter of map. But basically what this function does, it takes every element in that list of interleavings and puts h at the beginning of it. So this cons is basically takes an element and the list, and it creates a list that starts with that element and the rest of that list, the second list. So to respond to your question, this is an anonymous function that all basically what it does, for every list, it puts an element in front of it. So I can actually show you a simple example. Let's say that I call this map with this anonymous function that for every list, it puts one at the beginning of that list. And I call it with a list of lists. So this is 2, 3. This is 3, 2. And what basically map did, it put for every element basically of the list that is the second parameter, it put one at the beginning. So it puts that head back, because I get the permutations, the insertions, interleavings at a lower level, and now I put a head at the beginning.
All right, yeah, that makes a lot more sense now. So it's kind of like a lambda function of sorts?
Yeah. So basically anonymous functions, lambda functions, the idea of lambda functions are just another name for anonymous functions. Lambda functions are functions that do not have a name. They are called because of lambda calculus, but they are functions without a name. So yes, you're totally right. Lambda, these are lambda functions.
Oh yeah, that clarifies things a lot more. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay. More. So the idea of functional programming is very powerful in the sense that you can do a lot of interesting things, including partial application of the function. So this is actually another methodology called Caring. It's named after Harry Caray, that basically Haskell Caray, that basically started the Haskell programming language. And the idea is the following. So let's say that you define a function f that takes three parameters, a, b, and c, and is equal with a plus b plus c. Really, the way that this is seen is that this is a function that takes a, b, and c. But if you only pass one of the parameters, then you get a new function that takes the first parameter and is waiting for the second and third parameters. So really, the way that you should see when you write such a function, the result is that this is a function that takes an integer as a parameter, because this is the addition between integers. And the result is a new function that takes the rest of the parameters. And in fact, even those, it's basically a new function that takes an integer as the next parameter. And the result is a function that takes another integer and returns an integer, the result of the addition. So given such a function, you can basically now increment with one as basically a function that applies to the first parameter being one. The result is that now you can have a function that takes two parameters, adds them, and adds one to them. But again, you don't need to pass both parameters at once. You can now pass only the second parameter, increment with two. And this will be basically takes one, increment with one, and then increment with two as the second parameter. And again, is waiting for the third parameter. So really, the advantage of writing programs this way is that you don't need to pass all the parameters at once. You can pass partially some of the parameters from the beginning, and then is waiting for the rest of the parameters. Okay. So again, basically you can define a function, let's say f, and it takes multiple parameters, two parameters, and it results in a plus b. Okay. But I don't need to pass both parameters at once. Maybe I can basically just pass one of the parameters. I define increment one, a function that takes basically a, and all that it's basically doing, is f applied only to one. Okay. So it's basically and I don't need actually to pass the second parameter. I could pass the second parameter, which is actually b, but I can even ignore it. So now it's a value because I'm not quite defining, it's kind of a variable. It's not a new function. It's actually the same function as before, but parameterized to the first parameter one. So now increment one of nine, for instance, is 10, because basically now you have the first parameter set. The second parameter is actually the only thing that needs to be changed. So it's a partial application of functions. It takes partially the parameters from the beginning and is waiting for the rest of the parameters. Okay. It's also related to what is called lazy evaluation. Actually, most of the functional programming languages that do not evaluate anything until they actually need it. Okay. So Let's take a function, mult between x and y. And if x is equal with 0, then it returns 0, else it returns x multiplied with y. Eager evaluation basically says reduce as much as possible before applying the function. So for instance, multiplication between 1 minus 1 and 3 division with 0 would first evaluate in an eager fashion 3 divided by 0. And when it basically gets the result of that, it basically computes the multiplication of 1 minus 1. In lazy evaluation, the second parameter is never evaluated at all. So that error that we see in the eager evaluation is totally invisible because the function doesn't need a second parameter, doesn't need to invoke 3 division with 0. It only needs to evaluate the first one, and because that first one is 0, it will directly compute that the value of this function is 0. So there are two advantages of lazy evaluation. The first advantage is that it basically does what doesn't need to compute, it doesn't need to compute. So basically, the first advantage is the fact that you avoid errors that will be, because when you compute a larger expression, and this is related to imperative programming. So all of you, when we did Java last semester, we said that if you have a complicated expression, like for instance, 1 plus 2 multiplied with 3 plus 4, okay? What internally the Java compiler does, it computes, or Java interpreter does, it computes each one of the values of the inner expressions. So it will compute 3, and then it will compute 7, and then it will basically do the multiplication because it computes first what is inside parentheses. But this is not true about functional programming. Functional programming doesn't compute anything until it actually needs that value. So like in this case, although we have a second parameter, which is 3 divided with 0, which we know that it will trigger an error. In any programming language, division with 0 is undefined. It never actually computes it. It basically, if it's not needed, until when we actually need it, like for instance, in this case, we need x multiplied with y, then it will compute it. So lazy evaluation, first of all, avoids errors, and second of all, gives you higher efficiency. You only compute what you need. You don't ever compute anything that you don't need. You only compute it when you actually need it at that time. So that's the idea of carrying. Argument evaluation is done as late as possible, possibly never. Evaluation is done only when you actually need it for a reduction. Each argument is evaluated at most once when you need it. Lazy evaluation in SML is done for if then else, which is actually the main way to define functions in SML. And also, if you remember, it's basically a shortcut operator, or what basically, in order to evaluate the second parameter, the first operand has to be true, because if it's false, the second one is not evaluated, doesn't need to. Conjunction is true if both arguments are true. And similarly for all or else, if the first operand is true, the or else doesn't need to compute the second parameter, because the second operand, because the disjunction is true if at least one of the operands is true. If the first one is true, the second one doesn't need to be computed. Similar for pattern matching, when you actually define a function by patterns, you don't need to compute both operands, all of the patterns. You start one by one the patterns, and the first one that matches will be evaluated. Okay. And the property is that if eager evaluation of an expression E gives a value N1, the lazy evaluation of E gives a value N2. In the property should be that N1 should be equal with N2. But lazy evaluation gives you a result much more often because you get LN2 immediately. You don't actually compute N1 ever. And I will basically cover a few more functional, higher level functions before we do the lab for the day. We actually have enough time. So let's continue. So sum sequence. So sum, again, is a function that usually you want to apply for any number. So sum of a function on all the numbers from 0 to n. If n is equal with 0, then you return 0. Otherwise, is f applied to n plus sum of f and n minus 1. So basically, you apply the function first on the first element or on n, and then you decrement n to n minus 1. For instance, the sum of squares for up to 3. It basically takes 3, computes 9, then it takes 2 through recursion and computes 4, then takes 1 through computes 1, and then sums all of these values. 9 plus 4 plus 1 is 14. And that's how this basically worked. It's again a recursive definition and a higher level function. And let me actually show you the example. So really, it's the sum of all the applications of the function f on the sequence from 0 to n. So this is the function. And now let's say that I want sum of the squares. So I take the function that for every x, it returns x multiplied with x up to 10, let's say, not to 4. And basically, so the function took integers to integers. For every integer, I return the square. I do not know why this doesn't exactly work. Ah, it's because I use parentheses. So when you want to use carrying, you shouldn't use parentheses because basically, oops, it didn't work either. Maybe I have to put parentheses here. Yes. So basically with carrying, you can't use parentheses because you expect that this function takes multiple parameters and it takes them one by one. So because I defined it using carrying, I could have defined it without using carrying. I have to use it in the same way with parameters that come one after another, not as a function that takes all of the parameters at once. So really, it's just an effect of carrying. Okay, function composition. So another example of higher order functions is when you have two functions and you want to compute another function, which is f of g of x. So you compose f with g. You want to apply f on the result of g on x. So function composition takes two functions, f and g, and an element in the domain of the function g, and it returns f of g of x. So basically, the input, the function comp takes a function from A, the domain A to the domain B, a function from the domain C to the domain A, and it returns a new function from the domain C to the domain B. So basically, every C is transformed in A, A is transformed in B. So basically, the composed function transforms C to B. And for instance, let's take sinus and cosinus. So sinus of the cosinus of a real number is basically the result that we get from this function. So the new function, let's say the composed function of f with g will be a new function that applies the sinus for the cosinus first and then the sinus on the result. Okay. So let me actually show you the result. So this is the composition function, and this is the function f that composes sinus with cosinus. And now if I want f of basically 0.25, it will give me the value. The same can be obtained by using this circle. Circle is the composition predefined. So it's really, I should have probably just put it after the example here, because basically this is the same. It's a function that composes this sinus with cosinus. So g of 0.25 is exactly the same value that we had above. Okay. Find. Picks only the first element of a list that satisfies a predicate. It's similar to filter, but it doesn't continue on the rest of the elements. So first of all, if you apply it on an empty list, it raises an error. Otherwise, applied on a list that contains at least one element, X as the head of the list and X as the tail, if the predicate that we apply is true on X, then we return X. Otherwise, I call my find of the predicate and access the rest of the list. So for instance, I want the first positive value from a list. It basically applies the function on every element until it finds the first positive value, and then it succeeds immediately. It returns that first positive value. So that's the my find. It's a find first, really. Find first element for which that predicate is true. I will continue with the other higher level functions and more examples next class. At this time, I want to do the lab for the day. So today in the lab, we have two functions. The first function is reversing the digits of an integer. So for instance, reverse of 123 is 321. And it should also work for negative numbers. Reverse of minus 123 is minus 231. So I wrote it in two different ways. The first way is a straightforward helper function. So basically reverse digit helper takes the number and the previous result using the rest of the digits. If n is less than 10, then it returns just p multiplied with 10 plus n. Otherwise, it calls reverse helper recursively of the quotient of the division with 10 and p multiply with the previous number multiply with 10 plus the remainder of the division with 10. So really what happens? If you call reverse digit helper with 123 and 0, takes 3, multiplies 0 with 10 and adds the 2. So it's basically 3 because 0 multiplied with 10 is 0. It basically calls reverse helper of 12, the quotient of the division of 123 with 10 and 3. Now 3 is multiplied with 10 and adds 2 to it, basically the rest after division with 10 of 12. So in the next step, it calls reverse helper of the quotient of 12 with 10, divided with 10, which is just 1, and 32, the previous 3 multiplied with 10 plus 2. And in the next step, basically does 320 plus 1, which is 321. So it basically, you pass in the integer, it takes always the last digit and moves it to the partial number by shifting that number with basically one digit to the left. So that's exactly what happens. And then when you call reverse digits of n, if n is less than zero, it calls minus reverse digit helper of minus n and zero. Otherwise it calls reverse digit helper of n and zero. So reverse of 123 basically calls reverse helper of 123 and zero. And we saw how that results in 321. So this is the first definition, basically a straightforward helper function definition of defining reverse for a number. So reverse digits basically for some random number, it's basically reverses that using this recursive function. Okay. That's the first. The alternate solution is actually to extract from the original list a list of the digits, then start from the end and basically take the first digit, multiply it with 10 to the power of the position, take the second digit, multiply with 10 to the power of the position, and so on. So the second alternative solution works as follows. First, if you give a number, extract of 1,234, it gives you the list of digits in reverse order of that number, 4, 3, 2, 1, okay? Next, I need a power function, which basically given an integer, like for instance, power of 10 to the power, let's say 4. It gives 10 to the power 4, 10,000, 1 followed by 4 zeros. Power of 2 will be 100, 1 followed by 2 zeros, and so on. So it's a straightforward power function. Length is just the length of a digit. So for instance, length n of, let's say, 1,234, basically it says this integer has 4 digits, okay? And finally, we have the reverse helper function, which works in the same way that basically the previous function worked. So it basically for a list of numbers, so you pass in a list of numbers and the power minus one, the length minus one of that list. It basically starts from the beginning and multiplies 1 with 2 to, with 10 to the power 2, plus 2 multiplied with 10 to the power 1, plus 3 multiplied with 10 to the power 0. And that basically gives you 123. And finally, the reverse is just the reverse helper of the length of the list minus 1, or the length of the number minus 1, and the list of digits reversed in that number. So reverse of 1,234, it basically calls first extract that extracts the digits in reverse order. And then the length gives me the number of digits minus one in that list. And the reverse helper basically starts from the first element of that list and multiplies it with the powers of, and then decrements the power with one. And the tail of the list calls the reverse helper on the tail of the list. So it's always about seeing how do you solve a problem recursively with smaller functions, okay? The second problem, again, it's actually an interleave between two lists with a stride. So let me actually show you what I want first. Minimum is just the minimum of two elements. So basically it's just the minimum of two elements. Get n gets a list and a stride, basically how many elements I want from that list. And it gives me the first n elements of that list. Remove n takes the list and the stride and removes that many elements. So basically, I want to remove the first two elements in the list 1, 2, 3. It gives me just the list that contains 3. And these are straightforward definitions. Basically, I decrement and I skip the elements that I don't want to keep. And finally, I have how many, which basically, given the length of the current list and the stride, gives me the minimum. So it's really the minimum of the two. And interleave basically does the interleaving. So, and I want to keep a certain number of elements. I want interleave the two lists that I have here, 1, 2, 3, 4 with 5, 4, 6, 7. Start with the first list, take the first two elements, then the next two elements from the second list up to 5 elements. So it basically stops after 3. Okay. So let me explain how interleave works. and then I will let you for the day. So let you go for the day. Interleave takes two lists and the stride and the maximum number of elements. If the max number is less than one, then I return the empty list. If one of the list is empty, then I return the empty list. Otherwise, I get n elements from the stride number of elements from L1, and I append that to interleave with L2, with removing from L1 those number of elements that I basically already took out, the same stride, and the rest of the elements are basically how much I took out, the maximum number minus how many I took out. Okay, and that's basically it. I have an alternative solution which basically what is doing exactly the same thing, but instead of flipping the two lists as I do it here, it basically defines two functions, interleave list one and interleave list two, which are basically parallel recursive. One calls the other and the other one calls the first one. And that's basically what I'm doing in that implementation. I would say that the first definition is more than enough if you want to try it. Next lab, I will actually implement basically these two functions as we basically we finish the SML. There are two questions in the chat. I just saw that. Instead of passing one at a time, you can pass two divided by three. Ah, okay. So, yes. Instead of passing in carrying in partial application one element at a time, you can pass two or three or how many you want from the beginning to basically the end. So I understand the question. Let's say that we have a function sum that takes a, b, c, d, and is equal with a plus b plus C plus D. And now I want a new function, let's call it sum2, which is the same with sum applied to 1, 2. So now sum2 is a new function that takes the last two elements, okay? So I can pass 3 and 4. And basically, you already had one and two in the previous case out of the four, and I passed the other two. So Roger is right. Basically, you need, I eliminate parentheses because this is not the same with passing all of the elements at once. So really, what you are calling is f of one applied on two. Okay, so Quinton, is this clear? Okay, I assume yes. Okay, that's all for today. Yes, thank you very much. So I will still stick around if you have any other questions. That's all. I will stop the recording and post it on Piazza after I upload it to YouTube.